Hello everyone. So let us continue with our science and technology current affairs revision. So this is the part 2. The first issue we will see is about the AmbiTag. So what it is and the IIT Roper has developed it. So let us see more about it. AmbiTag, it is a device that records real-time ambient temperature. So ambi means it is a short form for ambient temperature during the transportation of perishable products, vaccines and even body organs and blood. So and this is a kind of an internet of things. Like internet of things is something which is like a connected devices and technologies these days. For example, you have the Alexa devices and all of those, the other such internet of things devices. Then it is developed by Indian Institute of Technology, Roper, Punjab. This is again important. What it is, it measures the ambient temperature, which is real time temperature, during the transportation of perishable goods. And the device has been developed under the Technology Innovation Hub Awadh, that is Agriculture and Water Technology Development Hub. So it is India's first indigenous temperature data logger for cold chain management. This is why it is important that it is India's first indigenous temperature data logger for cold chain management. Now, why is cold chain management so important? Because during the transportation of, say, vaccines and body organs and all of the perishable products, the firstly wastage gets reduced in terms of, say, like perishable products, etc. Secondly, for vaccines, now some vaccines, it may be that it is given under certain temperature conditions and temperature conditions, time, etc. So that those are some of the restrictions within which it has to be delivered. Then the third is for body organs, like some of the body parts, different body parts have to be different, have different time duration within which they need to be transported, so that this becomes important that a real time temperature is recorded. And then this AmbiTag is one such device which helps you to do that. Now it is developed by IIT Roper and it is India's first in the cold chain management, so it becomes important news. Next in news, we have the BCG vaccine 100 years and counting. So this was in news recently. Let us see more about it. BCG vaccine is basically a tuberculosis vaccine. Tuberculosis is caused by bacteria, right? And it affects what? Respiration, respiratory organs. And India has developed its own national plan. Now, Basal Calmette Guerin. So that is the full form of BCG vaccine, and it is given for tuberculosis disease. So Basal Calmette Guerin is a vaccine for tuberculosis disease, and we also have our own national plan in place, which is going to be for a year 2020 to 2025, in which India will try to eliminate TB by 2025. So that is a national strategic plan. So next in news, we have the Odisha tiger stripes. So what happened is that, you see this tiger stripes, how it is in the tigers in this figure, and then it looks like this. What it is a mechanism called as pseudomelanism. So pseudomelanism, what it is found that in Simlipal tiger reserves, the tigers in that have reported that in the black tigers, their stripes almost fused together in patches, threatening to obliterate the parts of their burnished orange coats. So like in this figure, this is how it is, but the real, it shows like this, and this phenomenon is called as the pseudomelanism. Now what was it? That it is characterized by wide merged stripes. As we can see here, the orange and the black stripes are merging. So it is a result of a rare gene mutation. What causes it is gene mutation, and that is the gene transmembrane aminopeptidase Q or tachypep. So it is related to something called as pseudomelanism. So remember that it is a mutated gene. So this gene gets mutated and that causes pseudomelanism. And we can also see it in cheetahs, but also why this news is important is because the mutation is rarely seen in tigers outside Simlipal. So this is a very specific characteristic or a unique trait which is seen only in the tigers from the Simlipal Tiger Reserve of Odisha. It is pseudomelanism, and melanism basically it is an enzyme or which gives you the color. So like the black skin color or the skin color and the texture. So in people who are more tanned, they have more melanin, and people who are like white skinned and all, they have lesser content of this enzyme melanin. And pseudomelanism causes the merging of orange and black patches in tigers, and which tigers? Specifically in Simlipal, because of the rare gene mutation called transmembrane aminopeptidase. Now next issue we have is the mapping of coral reefs which took place. Now the reason why I have included this in this is because this is a geographic concept of the, you should know the conditions for the coral reefs. So what is the temperature, 22 to 26 degrees Celsius temperatures, and the water should be like unsilted, on all of those that is covered in the geography basics of it. But why is this in news? Because researchers have completed a comprehensive online map of world's coral reefs by using more than 2 million satellite images from across the globe, and it is called as the Allen Coral Atlas. It is named after the this is not important, but what is the atlas called? That Allen Coral Atlas. And reference for reef conservation, marine planning and coral science. So it is the first global high resolution map of its kind, and it gives users the ability to see detailed information about the local coral reefs and all of that. So as we know that the Great Barrier Reef of Australia is the largest one, and it is much threatened because of the coral bleaching, the phenomenon called as coral bleaching. So the basics of coral you need to know, because the researchers have recently come up with an online comprehensive map, and it is the called as the Allen Coral Atlas. It will help you to even locate and all the local reefs and information about it. So the basics of coral reefs become important in this case. Now the coronavirus related very infamous thing happening. So the scientist body InstaGog, let us see more about it. This was in news some few months ago. Now InstaGog, as you can read here, is the Indian SARS-CoV-2 like coronavirus 2 genome sequencing consortium. So it is involved in sequencing the genomes of coronavirus samples in different states of India. So that is the full form of the InstaGog, and it is basically India's consortium for coronavirus related issues. So in InstaGog, read the full form here. It is a consortium, and it is a forum which is set up under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare by the Government of India in December last year, and to study and monitor genome sequencing and virus variation of circulating strains of coronavirus in India. So this is a consortium for SARS, that is coronavirus. Now colloquially, that is commonly it is known as coronavirus, but what is the scientific or the technical name of it? Severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS coronavirus 2, which is the virus that causes COVID, and it is a respiratory illness. As we know that it causes respiratory issues, cold, cough and all of that. Now it is said that it is of zoonotic origin. We know that. Now what is zoonotic origin? Any disease which comes from the animals to humans. For example, anthrax is caused by sheep, then rabies from rodents and other mammals. You have the West Nile virus near the Nile River and all, which is caused from birds, and again bird flu is very known in India as well. So this is of zoonotic origin. So just know the full form of it, and when was it constituted, what is the vision of it, also the scientific and technical name of coronavirus. Now the science behind GM crops. This article was in news recently. Now let us read some lines from this. More than 10% of the world's cropland grow genetically modified crops or GM crops. And what is the significance of it and what are the threats of it? We will see that later. So here, recently, why was this in news? Because recently Pune-based Agarkar Research Institute, which is an autonomous institute of the Department of Science and Technology, they have mapped two genes, which are those genes RHT14 and RHT15 in which crop? In wheat. So these are the two genes which by which institute and for which crop, that you have to remember. So what is this? These are the two alternate dwarfing genes in wheat associated with better seedling vigor and longer coelioptiles. So coelioptiles is this one, this thing. We have a wheat crop and this is how it grows, right? So the shoot tips that have we get. So for longer shoot tips, we are using these genes in the wheat crops. And this has researchers from Pune based the institute is based in Pune, Agarkar Research Institute, and they have mapped these genes. Now what are the other benefits of it? That's they say that because it will help you reduce the to avail the advantage of residual moisture in soil under dry conditions, so moisture problems get solved. Now about GM crops, we'll see more about the GM crops. Genetically modified crop is a gene artificially inserted into a crop from other species because so as to give some desired properties like pest resistance, herbicide tolerance, drought resistance, etc. So these are the some of the important issues in agricultural issues in crops, that they need to be pest resistant, herbicide tolerant and drought resistant. And in order to be able to do that, an outside gene is inserted artificially in the crop, and then that we call it a genetically modified crop. It becomes genetically modified. So currently in India, only GM crop permitted is the BT cotton. So there are frameworks. There is a well-established regulatory framework for approval of GM crops, and it is this one, and under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. So remember that it is under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Also, even though that the fact that only BT cotton is allowed. So BT, what is the full form of BT? It is Bacillus. BT is Bacillus thuringiensis. Thuringiensis. So remember this full form as well. But the illegal GM crops like brinjal and soybean are have been reported from across states. So now of the three GM crops, food crops in India, brinjal, mustard, and potato are still awaiting the permission by GEAC, that is Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. BT cotton is the only one, as we know, which is approved. And these three, that is brinjal, mustard and potato, it still has to get GEAC approval. Now GEAC is Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, and it is the apex body that allows commercial release of GM crops. Now there are certain concerns regarding GM crops, as we know, for human health, which is why the it is not easily granted permission to cultivate. And then that allergic reaction, gene transfer, and basically long-term health effects, health as well as environment, so and environment effects are still not known. So this is a very cause of concern for the GEAC in order to approve it them easily. Now let us see about the GEAC, that is Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. It was set up by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and then it regulates all the GM related issues. It is also responsible for approval of proposals relating to the release of genetically engineered organisms and products into the environment, including experimental field trials. Indigen program. So India has its own indigenous program, which aims to undertake the whole genome sequencing of 1,000 Indian individuals representing diverse ethnic groups from India. So since we are seeing about the genetic issues, so let us see about the genome sequencing of individual. So that India has indigen program, its own it will undertake genome sequencing of 1,000 Indian individuals, and is funded by CSIR, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research in India, autonomous body under the ministry. of Science, and it is the largest research and development body under the Ministry of Science and Technology. Now, Human Genome Project, it is an international project which was begun in 1990 and was completed in 2003. And what was the purpose of it? To determine the DNA sequence of the entire human genome. Now, a genome sequence spells out the order of each base nucleotide of the DNA, while genome mapping simply identifies a series of landmarks in the DNA. So, genome sequencing basically is this. So, we know that there are two, like reoxynucleic acid and deoxynucleic acid. So, RNA, the ribonucleic acid, is one single stranded, and DNA, that is deoxyribonucleic acid, is two stranded. It looks like a helix sphere like this. And this, so this is DNA, and it has something called as ATCG, ATCG, which is the different molecules or nucleotides that combinedly make up a single strand of DNA. That is A for adenosine, T for thymine, C for cytosine, and G for guanine. So these are the ATCG, and it is arranged in different manner, like CT, AG, and different permutations and combinations of it, and which is what makes the DNA of every individual different. And so that is so the, which is why the gene which forms the which is embedded in the DNA is specific to that particular individual, and so the identity is unique. And what we are trying to do through this project is that genome sequencing, genome mapping is going to be done. It is cleared in 2020 Ministry of Science. So this is the Genome India project. Now let us see some of the species which not like the extinct and all species, or which were found recently, or the relics, or the specimens of which were found. Like so they may give a name and ask you that what kind of a species of this, and where was it discovered, and all, what is it related to. Like last year or so, they had asked something about dinosaur discovery, the name of it and all. So we'll see some names. So S. Jaisalmerensis, so as in the name you can see there is Jaisalmer, so it's in Rajasthan. And what is it? It is a Jurassic era park, the shark, Jurassic era shark, which was found in Jaisalmer in Rajasthan. So as we can see here, researchers from the Geological Survey of India and the IIT Roorkee have discovered this thing, and in the Jaisalmer basin of Rajasthan, it's a shark of Jurassic era, and it is named as S. Jaisalmeris, that is Staphylodus. And why is this discovery important? Because this is the first record of Staphylodus genus from the Indian subcontinent. So what does that mean? That we know that we have a kingdom, then we have, so the order of it is like, first we have domain, then we have kingdom, then we have phylum, then class, order, then we have family, and then genus, and among that is species. So this is like a pyramid, downward pyramid we can say. So the maximum, the under the domain comes kingdom, then it goes on like decreasing to species, until species it is. So that is the ranks, 7 ranks are there. So this is the first Staphylodus genus from the Indian continent. So this is the genus. Where does it come? Here. So it was found there. So this discovery is important, and remember the name, where was it found, who found it. The Geological Survey of India and IIT Roorkee have discovered it in the Jaisalmer basin of Rajasthan. Next in news, we have something called as Paracetosporium. This is, it's a fungus. So remember that if in any scientific name you hear this word sporium, it is related to fungus. You see here, these are spores like these. These spores are there, and this is a new enzyme. The new enzyme it has given discovered that lignocellulose here. And why is it important? Because they believe that this discovery is important because there is much interest in using this enzyme which was found in this fungus as a renewable and sustainable resource for the production of liquid fuels and chemicals. So you see, out of the fungus also we will be able to now derive the fuels and all. So which is why this becomes important, that lignocellulose was something which was an enzyme which was discovered from the fungus called as Paracidosporium, this thing. Next we have Hungarian lake is in news because there were a lot of birds and now it is facing a severe drought. So lake to drought is a severe global issue, the environment. So in 1 year they had asked which of the following lakes are shrinking and all. You can also remember that Hungarian lake, there's a Hungarian lake which was a haven or a habitat for 100 types of birds, and it now faces severe drought. This was in news recently. Let us see about it more. So Lake Valens is its name, and it is a shallow freshwater lake which is located in central Hungary and which had many birds and tourists and all. So it is facing a lot of problems, and it is also Hungary's third largest natural lake. So why so? Because now they say that climate change and infrastructure and all those have gotten it to a devastating effect. So the Lake Valens in Hungary, remember that it was in news for facing severe drought. Now next we have new species called of cascade frog, which was discovered from Arunachal Pradesh, and it is named after the Adi tribe. So let us see more about it. That you should remember that the Western Ghats, first Western Ghats, second Northeast India, and third the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. These are the three biodiversity hotspots in India. Biodiversity hotspots. So if any species is recently found, there's a major chance that it is found in one of these three regions. So this cascade frog was found in the northeast state of Arunachal Pradesh, and it was named after Adi tribe. So remember this, because there's a hill called Adi Hills in Arunachal Pradesh, and it is named after the Adi tribe, cascade frog species. Now another species is Bharatristapani, whatever you may pronounce this as. It is a carnivorous reptile. So the Indian Statistical Institute of Kolkata, they have found this, and it was found at the Yerrapalli formation in Telangana. So this was, so Tapani is a carnivorous reptile found in the Yerrapalli formation in Telangana, and who has found it? Indian Statistical Institute of Kolkata. Next we have in news is the flying dragon. So Chile's Atacama Desert, they have unearthed the fossil remains of the so-called flying dragon, which is a Jurassic era pterosaur. P in this is silent. So pterosaur, previously known only to the northern hemisphere. So Chile, location of Chile is again important in South America here. Previously found in northern hemisphere, Chile almost comes to the south of like in the southern. Now another species, let us see. The Shuvia deserti, a nocturnal dinosaur. So it is a Cretaceous period dinosaur, and it was found in what today is Mongolia and China. So it is a deserti. Remember that deserti dinosaur, just by heart this. And deserti, and where is it found? In Mongolia and China. As we know, Mongolia is also called as flatland, because it is almost like table like plateau is there. That is the geophysical feature of it, and it is called as a flatland. Most of it being in the interiors of the Asian continent, it is deserted. So Mongolia and China, there Shuvia deserti, which was a nocturnal dinosaur, was discovered. that was about some of the important discoveries in the species. Now let us see some the space technologies. Gaganyaan program is very much in they're looking forward to it. So let us see more about it. It is the Gaganyaan program. It undertakes the putting humans in space, basically. So what is going to happen? A human space flight will be organized and to low Earth orbit in the short term by LEO. So the objective is that indigenously we are going to develop it, not with the help of NASA or anything. Indigenous program it is going to be, and human space flight mission to low Earth orbit. In a very short phrase, if you have to explain it, it is a human space flight mission to the low Earth orbit by ISRO. So ISRO is going to undertake it, and as a part of this program, 2 unmanned plus 1 manned mission. So let us see more about it. The total cost, remember this cost, it is about 9000 crore rupees. Remember that it is about 9000 crore rupees. The uncrewed missions are going to be for why? Technology demonstration, safety and reliability verification. Because before the putting humans into space, you need to verify whether it is safe or not. So for the two missions are going to be unmanned, and that uncrewed missions, and for technology demonstration, all those issues. Plus one is going to be manned, and there are going to be three people in it. So it is a major national effort, and ISRO will undertake it. It is an Indian crewed orbital spacecraft intended to be formative space program, and you see three people are going to be put through the manned mission. So when is the launch? June in next year, uncrewed mission, and next to next year, that is 2023, the crewed mission will go. Crew capacity is 3, and launch mass is 8200 crore. Remember this. Sometimes the masses can also be asked in the statements. So that was about the Gaganyaan program, which will be undertaken in the next year and next to next year. Now, National Biomedical Resource Indigenization Consortium. So recently this was constituted by the Department of Biotechnology of the Ministry of Science and Technology, and it is a public-private partnership. Why was this done? To drive indigenous innovation focused on developing reagents diagnosis. It's basically, it is a COVID-19 related, all the issues are going to be seen through this like consortium, and indigenous innovation issues. We saw that INSACOG consortium, that was also about COVID related research and all, but here in this, that is the National Biomedical Resource Indigenization, the word itself has it. So this consortium relates to the innovation which will focus on the COVID diagnostics and the vaccines and all of that. Now, hosted and led by the Center for Cellular and Molecular Platform, CCAMP. The mission is to, it's a nationwide platform for the convergence of research, product resources and services towards developing reagents, diagnostics, vaccines and therapeutics across India for COVID-19 response. Now it's a Make in India initiative for biomedical research and innovative products towards import substitution and export. So it will be hosted and implemented by the CCAMP. Let us see more about the center. Center for Cellular and Molecular Platforms. Center for Cellular and Molecular Platforms. Remember the full form. And it is by the DBT, that is Department of Biotechnology and Ministry of Science. And it is going to be a center for technology-based innovation and entrepreneurship in the field of life sciences. So this is the aim of it, and it was launched for COVID-19 Innovation Deployment Accelerator is also launched under it to help identify and accelerate the COVID infection related solutions. Next we have the Arogya Setu data access and knowledge sharing portal protocol. So why this protocol was put into place? Basically for the privacy related issues. As in the case of Aadhaar, whatever happened, we saw that privacy issues were a major concern about it. So they also put a protocol this time regarding the Arogya Setu information storage and all. So under which act? Disaster Management Act of 2005. This is very important that under this act, they will provide legal safeguards for the operation of the mobile application, the Arogya Setu application, and the clear limitations are set out by the protocol. Now it basically defines the phrase appropriate health responses as this. So read it from here, that it is defining this phrase. Firstly, Secondly, there is a sunset clause. What does it mean? That whenever the Aarogya Setu will collect the data about the individual, it shall cease to operate after 6 months from the date of its issuance. Like the protocol basically will do that, and again the data will be deleted 180 days after the collection. So that is the one of the thing about it. And sunset clause basically means it will stop operation after the 6 months of its issuance. And under the privacy related concerns, they will not keep any contact and location related information, and it will be permanently deleted 180 days after the collection of it. Remember that Aarogya Setu app is available in 11 languages, just in case. And Bluetooth technology is also used in it, that we know as of now. So that was about the protocol. Now let us see something about blockchain technology, a very famous and useful technology if used properly. Some of the basics about it is that it is an innovative distributed ledger technology. So the ledger is distributed firstly. Second, that it was first introduced by introducing the cryptocurrency under it called Bitcoin. We know this Bitcoin cryptocurrency is a very famous one. There are many, but this one is the famous one. And the first time it happened in 2009 by a supposed individual called as Satoshi Nakamoto. Nobody has seen this individual, nobody knows where he lives and all, but it is supposedly called this name, by this name. And it is a distributed ledger technology. It means that there is no central database for it, so it is decentralized, and there is a large network of untrusted entities. Now obviously it is permissioned and permissionless. Permissionless can be used for a lot of cyber related issues and e-governance and all, like healthcare, cyber security, governance, legal issues, education and all of those issues. So now the technology, what it basically does is eliminates the requirement of the centralization. So this is an important factor about it, which is also a factor of concern of it. Like there is a, for example, in case of cash transactions, we have a central bank like RBI. So whatever happens, RBI regulates the cash and money transaction. So there's a central agency, just in case anything happens, we can hold this agency responsible. The individuals can go to these banks and all. So this is a regulatory authority. But in case of bitcoins or blockchain technology, there's no such central authority, which makes it difficult in case any kind of fraud and any kind of unforeseen or anything that you know, it happens, so nobody can hold anyone responsible. So a lot of loss can happen in that case, which is why that's a cause of concern, for example in cases of cryptocurrencies and all of that. Now just since you are seeing these issue terms, let us see what non-fungible token, which was also a term in use, what it is. It is a unit of data stored on a digital ledger called a blockchain, and it certifies a digital asset to be unique. So basically it is a digital asset identity, unique identity for a particular digital asset. Like for example, we have a cash note, which is a tangible asset, and we can it is an interchangeable asset. So like NFTs are non-fungible, that is non-interchangeable. Fungible is like we can interchange it. So NFTs can be used to represent items such as photos, videos. It is related to blockchain technology. Just remember that it is related to a blockchain technology, and it is a unit of data which is stored on a digital ledger. So this is the blockchain technology. This is how it operates. So client initiates the transaction. And the most important feature, two features are there in blockchain technology. There's a peer-to-peer transaction, and then there is no central authority. So peer-to-peer network. So there are many networks which are interconnected, and then there's a peer-to-peer network. They get validated, and then verification and added to the ledger. So this is a blockchain. So there's a chain like this, and then stakeholder verify the transaction details. So this is the blockchain network and the process of adding new transaction to the ledger. So potential blockchain applications in the national interest, as we saw that it can be a very very useful technology if used properly and if all the concerned issues are somehow handled, but currently no such thing is there. So where can it be useful? In the transferring of land records, pharmaceuticals, power distribution, duty payments, etc. What will happen is a lot of paperwork will get reduced. And land records can be, you know, properly maintained and used whenever required. So that in a very systematic and a very organized manner, we can conduct all these businesses, and human intervention and the piling of all this paperwork will get reduced if we use this properly. Similarly, agriculture, e-voting, digital health and all of that, Internet of Things, chit fund operations administration, microfinance for the self-help group, in all the, basically in all the sectors, right, from agriculture to banking to governance services to pharmaceutics to medicines, all of these can be properly put to use through blockchain technology if used properly. Now, IRNSS, that is Regional Navigation Satellite System. Why was this in use? So, PIB has come up with this article saying that India's IRNSS is now a part of Worldwide Radio Navigation System. Previously, it was just regional. Now, it is a part of Worldwide Regional Navigation System. Now, let us see more about it. Who does this? Who has given this? That the International Maritime Organization has put it in the worldwide network. So, IRNSS, that is Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. It is our independent regional navigation system, and it provides accurate position up to 1500 kilometer from its boundary. So this is the boundary of India, and the 1500 kilometers around it is covered. So other nations in the Indian Ocean also get covered in this. So an extended service area lies between the primary service and this is just the technical details of it. No need to remember this, just remember that up to 1500 kilometers was covered. Basically, it is like a GPS system, the global positioning system that we use. Now, Indian regional navigation is the regional one, GPS is of global. Now, IRNSS, it will provide two types of services, as you know, standard one and a restricted one. Standard is provided to all the users, and restricted obviously to the authorized users, like the Coast Guard, for example. They can use the restricted services. Now the accuracy is 20 meters. Okay, so that was some of the issues in the science section, current affairs. We'll continue in the last part. The remaining issues will continue in the last part. Thank you.